Okay, last time we went on a short tour of the universe, starting from our home place, the Earth, and basically went all the way out to the largest structures in the universe, the superclusters of galaxies. In the process, we saw that depending on the circumstances, we use different yardsticks for measuring the distance. For the distances, say, on Earth, or maybe even up to the Moon, kilometer is appropriate unit, because the distances, when expressed in kilometers, are given by numbers that are not too large. They are not high powers of 10. But then, when we go on a bigger scale, for instance, when we talk about the distances of Earth and other planets from the Sun, then kilometers become too small, right? The average distance between the Earth and the Sun is 150 million kilometers. So it makes sense to introduce a new yardstick that has that scale, and we call that average distance between the Earth and the Sun of 150 million kilometers one astronomical unit. And then when we go to a scale large enough, so that we are talking now about the distances between the stars, the astronomical unit becomes too small. And more appropriate unit is the light year, which is the distance which light traveling at the speed of 300,000 kilometers per second covers in 1 year, right? And when you do the math, turns out that one light year is about 10 to the 13 kilometers. 10 trillion kilometers, or 63,000 astronomical units. Okay, so the time has come to start describing what is it that one sees when you look at the night sky. And first thing is that we see the individual stars. What I'm showing here is a sky chart, which there is one like this one for every month of the year. I'm showing here the night sky in May. So basically the way to read these charts is if I'm, say this is south. So if you're looking at the south, then you should turn this chart so that at the bottom it says southern horizon. If I'm looking north in the opposite direction, then I have to turn it so that it says northern horizon at the bottom, okay? So if you want to do some stargazing and identify the stars and constellations, which are just the groups of stars in the sky, then this kind of chart is handy. So we see individual stars. As examples, I will point out here Polaris, or the North Star. This one is important because it happens that the point on the night sky that is directly above the Earth's North Pole, directly above the north-south spin axis of the Earth, it happens to be very close to where Polaris is. Okay? So when it, and we'll talk a little bit about that as we go along, in navigation, it's extremely important to be able to locate the true north. That will not always be the case. As you'll see later on, the Earth's spin axis actually precesses, like a hubcap that falls on the ground. And it precesses once in 26,000 years. So that, for instance, in 13,000 years, there will be another star closest to this so-called North Celestial Pole, and it will be Vega. Which is part of the constellation of Lyra. And of course, there are others. There is Antares here, part of the Scorpius, which is now low in the eastern horizon. Spica, which is part of the constellation Virgo, and so on. In addition to individual stars, you realize that as you look at them, they tend to form certain groupings. I mean, and that is, of course, there are no lines in the real world. They are just drawn here to emphasize the grouping of star. And these groups of stars that lie in about the same direction are known as constellations. Okay? So, for instance, there is Leo here. This grouping of star resembles perhaps a lion. Here is the head of the lion, right? A lion is lying down. So here is the head. Here is the Cancer. I mentioned before Scorpius. There is another one, Ophiuchus, that actually, strictly speaking, should be part of the zodiac circle, right? The horoscope, if you look up the horoscope in the paper, it has 12 signs. Well, there should strictly be the 13th one because it's part of, as we will discuss in detail later on, but it is not. It is often used, in fact, it was named after a healer in an herbalist in Greek mythology. In addition to these constellations, such as Leo, Cancer, and so on, there are so-called asterisms. And examples of these asterisms, so they are not true constellations, are these groupings like a Big Dipper and a Little Dipper. Okay? Polaris is actually a star at the end of the handle of the Little Dipper. And the way to locate it, you basically locate these two so-called pointer stars in the Big Dipper, and then you continue in the same direction of these two pointer stars, and then the star that is at the tail or at the end of the handle of Little Dipper is Polaris, the North Star. They are part of bigger group of stars that do form a constellation, but are not as visible, easily visible, as those outlining Big Dipper and Little Dipper. And they are part of constellations. The Big Dipper, that asterism, is part of constellation Ursa Major, which is Latin for Big Bear. And Little Dipper, that asterism, is a part of a constellation Ursa Minor, which is Little Bear. Okay? So we have individual stars, we have constellations, and we have these so-called asterisms.